thank you, Dr. Luman. It is so good to be home again at Wesley Biblical Seminary. Could I call your attention this morning to the reading of the Word? I'm going to be reading from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 7, and also from chapter 5 of 1 Peter. Clement Hall looks good. The long-awaited carpet looks good. What a joy to be back at Wesley Biblical Seminary. I'm especially pleased to feel more at home than you might expect for someone who graduated in 2004, because so many of my dear friends from Wesley College are here. And we greet you from Wesley College this morning, your sister school down in Florence. 1 Peter, chapter 1, verses 3 through 7. And chapter 5. As the bulletin points out, I'll be preaching from verses 5 through 10 of chapter 5, but for context's sake, I would like to read from chapter 1 as well. 1 Peter 1. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These trials have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Chapter 5. To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, a witness of Christ's sufferings, and one also who will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not greedy for money, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety upon Him, because He cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of suffering. And the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To Him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Father, would you now bless the reading and the preaching of your word among your people, and speak through your servant this morning. For your glory, we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. In 1921, a Scandinavian couple from Sweden, so in love with Jesus, answered a call to be missionaries in Africa. And they landed in a country at that time called the Belgian Congo. We now know it as Zaire. David and Svea Flood found themselves ministering among the Congolese people there. And having served with their two-year-old son in the region, decided that they wanted to venture out from the central mission camp and reach people who had never heard the gospel. And so they found themselves near a little village called Indalera. The village chief wanted absolutely nothing to do with the gospel or with this message that was being brought by these Swedish people, the Floods. The Floods had with them another couple from Scandinavia, the Ericssons, and for a period of 6 months, they attempted to live and minister in the region. Unable to live in the village of Andalera, the couples built little mud huts up the side of the mountain just away. And the village chief would not allow any contact of his people with these missionaries except for one little boy who brought chickens and eggs which might be sold to the Scandinavian missionaries. Eventually, the Ericsons lost faith in this particular approach and left and went back to the central mission station. And by this point, little Zve Flood, 4'8", 1921, found herself pregnant with all the problems of early 1900s Africa, malaria. Eventually, she gave birth to a little baby girl. Still no contact. Zve Flood had decided that if she could do nothing except live in her mud hut and talk to one little boy, she would win him to Jesus. And that she did. The little boy professed faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. 17 days after the birth of their little girl, Zve Flood succumbed to malaria. She passed along, and her late husband, David, with a 2-year-old in tow and an infant baby girl, stormed back to the mission station saying, "God has ruined my life, and there's no way that I can take care of this little baby." And he disappeared back to Scandinavia. The couple who had been with little Ina, as she was called, took her for the next several months until they too, the Ericsons, succumbed to some strange African disease. And eventually, Ina found herself in the care of some American missionaries who, when she was 3 years old, moved back to South Dakota. And there, with a new name, Aggie, Americanized, she grew up, went to North Central Bible College, and wondered most of her life what had ever happened to David Flood. This broken man, shaking his fist at God after seemingly having given everything that he might serve the very God he thought betrayed him. It is with fear and trembling that I return to Wesley Biblical Seminary to bring a message. And I've asked myself for a period of months, what message would I have want to have heard when I was a seminary student? Now, I'm sure that my good professors, my seminary chapel speakers did communicate these things to me. But if I could speak to myself 10 years ago, this message is what I would want to bring. 1 Peter chapter 5, and for the tactile kinesthetic learners among us this morning, these are postures, three postures of an effective minister of the gospel. And here's a hint for you. This posture of David Flood towards the God who had called him is not the effective posture of a minister of the gospel. And Peter tells us that the first thing that we should expect ministers of the gospel to do is to be humble. And it's more than just to be humble. You see the word humble and humility repeated there, in verses 5 and 6. Clothe yourselves with humility. You see, this is an active verb. When you get up this morning, you put on your clothes. When you get up this morning to serve your people, you ought to put on humility. It's not just a descriptive or ontological statement that we should be humble. Some people say that if you're humble, you wouldn't know it. But that's not true here from the Scripture. We are to put humility on as our clothing. Verse 6 says we should humble ourselves. Humble ourselves. Now, why would we humble ourselves? The Scripture here, quoted in James 4 as well, quotes Proverbs. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. I was at the basketball game last night. Wesley College came from a 5-point deficit with 30 seconds to go and beat Tougaloo last night in overtime there in Florence. I'll tell you what, I enjoy going to a college basketball game. What would terrify me is walking onto the court and discovering that God was on the other side. And if in your life you want to find God on the other side playing for the other team, a good way to do it is to be proud. God opposes the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. So what should you do? Well, the Scripture here says you should humble yourselves, an act of your own will, your own volition. And it seems to me one reason to humble ourselves is so that God doesn't have to do it for us. We should humble ourselves under God's mighty hand. God's mighty hand, the God of deliverance, has a mighty hand with which he delivers. The God of judgment also has a mighty hand with which he judges. I would prefer to humble myself under the mighty hand of deliverance. And then what next? What after we humble ourselves? He will lift us up in due time. I have a dear friend right now in Ochsner's Hospital in New Orleans. I met him in a class with Dr. Matt Friedman. He was in church planting with me. His name is Jim Kane. The entire time I've known him, he has told me, Keith, God has called me to be a missionary. I'm supposed to be a missionary. It's been a joyous ride just to be his friend. He was here and God introduced him in his early 30s to a widow lady whom he married. They have three wonderful children. And this summer, I had the opportunity because a benefactor in our church said, Jim, you should go on this mission trip with Keith. And he sent us. And on that mission trip, Jim said, all these years, I've been thinking I was supposed to be a missionary to Mexico. And I was all these years supposed to go to Belize. When he came back, they'd had their house, which had been devastated by Hurricane Katrina, and they'd put it back together. It had been on the market for 6 months, and they had a contract on the house. And all the doors flew wide open for him to immediately make his way to Belize. And so, just as recently ago as last month, Jim was in Belize on a two-week exploratory journey to get ready to go to Belize as a missionary. When some strange disease struck him, and he was airlifted to Gulfport, and I got the news when he was fine on Monday that by Friday he was not expected to make the evening. 36 years old, with a call to minister as a missionary, graduate of Kentucky Mountain Bible College. My friend Wayne Sellers, many of you would know him, had introduced us to the ministry in Belize, and he was the one who called me to give me the news that Jim would not make the night. But Wayne told me this. He said, Keith, many people who do not even know Jim have been praying for him, and I believe that God wants to heal him. And Jim did make the night, and he did make the flight to Ochsner's, and day by day they were able to dial down the respirator so that his lungs might be healed. It's not the kind of entrance into our mission field that most of us will have. But it occurs to me that when the Lord does complete his healing of Jim Kane, and Jim Kane does go to Belize as a missionary, which I say by faith this morning, believing in the prayers of God's people and what people like Wayne Sellers have told me will happen, that Jim will be keenly aware that every breath that he breathes is a gift from God. Nothing more humbling than a machine having to do your breathing for you. Not every one of us at Wesley Biblical Seminary will go into our first position of ministry with that kind of a humbling experience. But God's Word would say to us this morning that we need to humble ourselves. I don't think we ever express it consciously, but I think somewhere in the back of our minds there is this kind of thought process rolling for us. Isn't it enough that I have a college degree and I'm working for minimum wage at Blackwell Chevrolet? Isn't that enough humility? Isn't it enough that being at Wesley Biblical Seminary has destroyed my credibility as a biblical scholar across most of the world? Isn't it enough, David Flood, that I'm living with a dirt floor in a region where I can't even preach the gospel to anyone except a boy with a chicken and eggs at the door? Shouldn't I be exempt from humiliating myself, from humbling myself before the Lord? And the answer, Wesley Biblical Seminary, is no, it is not enough. And at Christmas time, we celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ, who humbled himself and left heaven and came to earth. We celebrate the incarnation. And he became obedient to death, even to death on a cross. The most gifted of the seminarians, I would say, in the years that I was here at Wesley Biblical Seminary, was telling me at the end of his stay, I feel like the last person picked at a game of kickball. You may find yourself at the end of your Wesley Biblical Seminary experience wondering, does anyone even know you have this MA or this MDiv? Is there a place for you to serve in the church? And God's Word would say to you, humble yourself under God's mighty hand. And in due time, He will lift you up. And so it's a posture. It's a posture of humility. I'm so grateful that I grew up in a church where there was an altar for me to pray, where I could prostrate myself before the Lord and in a posture of humility say, God, You're in charge, I'm not. Can I tell you something else about verse 7? When you're on your knees or your face before the Lord, that's a great posture to be in if you want to unload your anxieties. And I know this time of the semester there are many anxieties in this room. In a posture of humility, we can cast all our anxiety on God. And it's fascinating to me that the reason that Peter says we can cast all our anxiety on God is not because He's strong and big and can take it, but because He cares for us. We should have a posture of humility as ministers of the gospel. The second posture I want to call out to us is in verses 8 and 9 there. It is a posture of alert resistance. So I don't know what this posture would necessarily look for you. I can imagine myself being in a posture of humility. Oh, would you please go out on a date with me? And someone saying, no, I will not. So maybe that is your posture of alert resistance. When I graduated from Wesley Biblical Seminary in 2004, a few people gave me some lovely gifts. But the one that is most enduring is Smokey the Cat. Smokey the Cat was the gift that my mom gave me in 2004. And he is the primary occupant of 512 Altawoods Boulevard because, as Dr. Luma told you, I'm never there. I am ashamed to tell you how much I like Smokey the Cat. And so at 3 in the morning, you might find him curled up on a winter's evening next to his master. Do you know what our problem is? Many of us, even ministers of the gospel, are curled up, asleep, not realizing that the feline next to us is a roaring lion. We are to firmly resist the roaring lion of Satan. Be alert, the text says. Be self-controlled. You have an enemy who is out to get you this morning. He's out to get you, yes, in seminary. I've been through one of the most remarkable experiences of my life. I graduated from Wesley Biblical Seminary really not having much of a clue of what I was going to do with this degree once I got it. Now, once Wesley College hired me, it all made such good sense. I'd been hanging around Wesley College for 10 years. Most of my life I've spent on a college campus, and I said, oh, Lord, You did a great job with that. And I thought I'd found my ministry until my phone rang one October afternoon, and it was a church that had almost closed 10 years earlier, and they needed somebody just this one Sunday to come preach for them. And I thought, well, if I could pray and fast for a church to stay open 10 years ago, the least I can do is go preach one Sunday there. And I discovered that my district superintendent was willing to send me to lots of churches in between pastors. And the experiences I'd had growing up being just so sad because my pastor had left were being used by the Lord Jesus Christ in these churches in between pastors, disappointed, not sure which direction would come next. And so the phone call came on Palm Sunday 6 months later, and it was Crossroads Church, and they wanted somebody to come preach Palm Sunday. And so I went to Dr. Oswalt, and I said, Dr. Oswalt, can I preach Psalm 22 on Palm Sunday to this church? And he said, yes, I think you can do that. And I said, thank you, Dr. Oswalt. And I called my friends and I said, would you please pray? I've got to preach at Crossroads. I never preached at a church more than 50 people or so. And Crossroads was a big up-and-coming church, over 100 people now. And I told one of my friends that was praying for me, I said, you need to pray for me. I'm going to be preaching at Crossroads this Sunday. And she said, well, is there any chance that you could go there? And I laughed out loud at her and said, no, this is a good church. And 3 sermons later, when every sermon I had preached was from a text which had just been sung by the worship leader with no organization at all on our behalf to arrange such a thing. And after I gave a key illustration where one of the ladies of the church stood up and told the rest of the story, because in a way I had no idea had happened 20 years before she'd been a part of the story. I walked away saying, "What just happened?" And so, about 2 years ago in October, a new pastor on board took me out and I said, "Pastor, I want you to call for my letter. I think I'm supposed to be at church here." And he said, "Well, tell me what you like about the church." I said, "Well, you know, we'd just been through Hurricane Katrina. We dropped from 200 people down to about 180 again, and 40% of our people had water in their houses, and we were trying to figure out what was coming next. And staff meetings were like, where's the youth pastor? Oh, he moved to Tupelo. Didn't you know that?" I said, "I don't see anything standing between this church and 500 folks. And he said, "Keith, I'm not going to call for your letter. I'm going to put you on staff here." And Crossroads Church has been such a gift to me. I cannot imagine. And story after story has come down. I taught the 301 class, still teach the class, and one of the ladies in the church said, "Let me tell you what I love so much about Crossroads. I love this church because it is a church of energy and passion and vision." She finished her sentence. And I said, in the back of my mind, "Yep, and that's why they called me." I was so concerned as a single person coming out of Wesley Biblical Seminary that there would not be a church for me to serve in. One Sunday evening after the church had one of those